Welcome to the Wade Centers podcast.
A podcast of Wheaton College.
And then you have to stop and reread it because you think they can't have actually said this. So there is actually a statement in one of Q.D. Leavis's works where she talks about the worst thing that ever happened to literature was the rising literacy rate. So as more people were able to read, her argument is literature was then dumbed down to the common person.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's exactly what Sayers is trying to counter, to say, no, this was great.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to embrace this and write to everyone and right. not just the elite.
We have a great opportunity today because we have in this room three people who have been studying for decades, one of the persons who is the most important influence on C.S. Lewis's spiritual life, Dorothy Sayers. And the occasion is to discuss a book that has been published with Routledge by Christine Colone called Writing for the Masses, Dorothy L. Sayers and the Victorian Literary Tradition. And joining in the conversation is the Associate Director of the Wade, Marjorie Mead. So, Christine, thank you for being here. And Marge, thank you for being here. So, let's start. Christine, how did you initially get interested in Dorothy Sayers?
Well, my initial interest in Sayers began when I started teaching at Wheaton College. And I knew we had this great resource. And I, growing up, had always loved detective stories, but I had never actually read Dorothy Sayers, or I had read her first novel, Whose Body, unfortunately didn't really like it that much, and didn't read her for many years, but thought, okay, I'm here at Wheaton College, and why don't I give her another try? And so I started reading some of her later detective fiction, and that's really when I thought, she's an interesting writer, and I might be able to do some interesting work on her.
Mm. Marge, how did you get interested in Dorothy Sayers?
Actually, started reading her. My mother-in-law had recommended some of her mysteries, and so I began with the mysteries and then very quickly started reading the essays and so on, but it was probably following fairly close after college.
Okay. It's interesting, Christine, you talked about once getting the job at Wheaton, that steered your attention to her. The exact same thing happened to me when I got a job at a Christian college and wanted to pursue this particular woman that I knew was so influential. Now, the title of your book is Writing for the Masses. Can you explain why you titled it that?
Sure. One of the things that I really wanted to do with my book is I wanted to really draw scholars' attention to Sayers because I think she is really worth studying. And in literary scholarship, there aren't many people who pay attention to Sayers.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the reasons they don't pay attention to Sayers is she is writing for the masses. And she's writing for the masses at a time when we tend to pay attention to the writers who were not. So we're looking, literary scholars tend to pay attention to writers like Virginia Woolf or James Joyce, who are writing for very intellectual audiences who are willing to kind of work with the complexities of their language and their lack of plot oftentimes. And so that title, Writing for the Masses, really conveyed the difference in Sayers. She was writing for a more popular audience, but at the same time, I wanted to kind of convey the value of that in her time period.
Mm-hmm. Right. One of the things that I found intriguing about your book is you teasing out the word middle brow audiences. And why it caught my attention is that there was a recently published book about C.S. Lewis that basically argues almost in a dismissive way that the reason Lewis is so popular is that he appealed to middle brow readers, especially American readers. So why don't you talk about that term middle brow?
Sure. It's really in the early 20th century that we get the term middle brow. It develops along with low brow and high brow. And It's an interesting term because literary scholars tend to focus on the highbrow. Lowbrow is, you know, well, that's just popular fiction. We don't pay attention to it. Middlebrow is the challenging kind of concept there because it is both written for a popular audience, but at the same time, the authors are trying to do something of literary merit. And what's fascinating is that in the early 20th century, those who were highbrow writers or those who were supporting highbrow writers actually oftentimes hated the middlebrow worse than the lowbrow because they felt that the middlebrow writers, they were trying to be pretentious and trying to put on these airs of being respectable when they were writing for a popular audience. And so I'm interested in the scholarship that looks at the middlebrow writers and doesn't dismiss them in that way, to say, no, there's actually something valuable here. What really interested me as well is that often the middlebrow writers were doing things that the Victorians had done earlier. And I'm trained as a Victorianist. And, you know, the writers then who could be called middlebrow were Dickens and the Brontes and writers that we now see as classics. And so I was interested in thinking about what's that difference that happens between the Victorian period, when you could be a middlebrow writer and still be respectable in today's scholarly world, and the early 20th century, where to be a middlebrow writer doing essentially things that the Victorians had done before was suddenly no longer valuable.
Did you do any research into the etymology of the term highbrow and middlebrow? I just imagine these people reading the book, their poetry, with their eyebrows raised up as high as possible to capture the art, and middlebrow, they're just level. But lowbrow is like the eyebrows are under the eyes. I just don't. It's such a fascinating term.
It is. I didn't really research it that much, but that's exactly the image that I have as well. Yeah.
Well, this leads to a question that I would ask Marge as well as Christine, because you both read a lot of detective fiction more so than I do. Why do you think Agatha Christie is so famous as a detective fiction writer? And of course, she was contemporaneous with Dorothy Sayers. They attended Detection Club. They were both in the London Detection Club. Any theories? And is it related to highbrow, middlebrow, lowbrow?
It's an interesting question. I definitely think that Agatha Christie sometimes is underrated because she is so popular. I mean, there's still value there. I think that a lot of people get attracted to the characters and then just stay with them. And they aren't terribly, they aren't necessarily big detection readers, I think. But I've never really explored it or looked at the critical response. Sayers herself was not that fond of Agatha Christie's mysteries. They're very different. I do know, for example, I read Agatha Christie and enjoyed her really in grade school. And I don't go back to her. So, you know, occasionally I'll see a movie or a PBS special. But so that's not negating that there's value there. But I think it's not. I will reread Sayers, for example. I don't reread Agatha Christie.
I think that is, yeah, that's a key distinction. I, too, read Agatha Christie in grade school, middle school. And one of the key differences, I think, Agatha Christie wrote many more novels. Certainly, she lived longer than Sayers did. But I think she was able to write more novels because her novels tend a little bit more towards the puzzle type of detective novel. Which is fun and it's, you know, it's enjoyable to read, but like Marge, I don't go back and read Agatha Christie. I mean, once you have figured out, you know, once you've read Murder on the Orient Express, you know the ending, there's really no reason to go back and reread it. In contrast, for Sayers, I will reread her novels, and I reread them because I'm interested in the characters. I'm interested in the themes. I can go back and discover new things. So for me, reading a Sayers novel is not simply, oh, what's the puzzle? but it's the story she creates around the puzzle. And I actually think that's one of the reasons why I wasn't as impressed with her first novel, Whose Body, because it's more of the puzzle. And I had to get into Gaudy Knight, Nine Tailors, and the more rich novels. Though, interestingly, now that I've read those, I can go back to Whose Body and see how she is actually setting up things she develops later on. So now I can actually appreciate that much better.
And
you want okay. Christine, very early in your book, you mention appropriately that with Sayers' first class honors, she certainly had the cultural credibility to enter into the world of the highbrow modernist writers, but she didn't pursue this path. Now, you also talk about her attempt to be a poet, which certainly was in that train. Could you elaborate a little bit more on this aspect of her lack of success? And then I have a follow-up question.
Sure. I do find it interesting that she started off with poetry, though interestingly, her poetry doesn't really fall in with modernist poetry.
Mm-hmm.
It's very much kind of hearkening back.
Right.
And I honestly think that for Sayers, one of the key things that was a motivation for her was the fact that her father was kind of bankrolling her while she was trying to, you know, make her own way in the world. And, you know, reading through her letters, I get a sense that she started to feel kind of guilty about that and wanted something that would pay. And her poetry wasn't successful. I mean, it was pretty clear she wasn't going to have a career as a poet. And earlier she had kind of played around with the idea of writing detective fiction. And I think once she was able to do that and thought, I can do this well and I can actually make money with this, that became a motivation where it was like, okay, I'm still writing, but here at least I'm making money. And so hopefully that will be a way that I can be self-sufficient. Of course, it also helped when she got a job working in advertising that gave her a, you know, regular paycheck. But I do get the sense that, you know, she wanted to be independent. She didn't want to be, you know, the daughter trying to make it in London as a poet while her father was paying all of her bills.
Mm-hmm. Well, she explicitly says in her letters that I'm going to try detective fiction because that's where the money is. She loved screenwriting and she was doing that in France, but just being in France after the Great War was not the place where you could get screenplays made into movies. So her motivation explains why Whose Body doesn't have the same depth and richness as others. One thing that has always fascinated me, and some of our listeners may not even know about the primary character in Sayers' detective fiction, his name is Lord Peter Whimsy, and Sayers quite explicitly chooses not to make him a Christian, not religious. He appreciates the beauty of the tradition, the beauty of churches and cathedrals, but he's not religious. Why do you think Sayers did that?
Oh, I think there are a number of reasons why she did that. I think one reason is that it gave her more latitude, what she could do with his character. And, you know, he has a rather colorful past. And so it allowed her to play with those ideas. I also think, I mean, she had great respect for Chesterton, who with his Father Brown mysteries had, you know, the firmly Christian, you know, detective. And I feel like she wanted to, try something different. I also just feel like for Sayers, once she started delving into the character, she was very much committed to letting the character be who the character wanted to be. And she felt like the way that she had crafted him, that he wouldn't develop in the way that perhaps some of her readers wanted him to. She mm-hmm. did get letters from readers, you know, where it was, oh, where's that conversion? You know, when mm-hmm. is that going to happen? And she really felt, well, that wouldn't be true to the character. And I think that is actually one of the key reasons why she is kind of in this middle brow category as opposed to the popular category, in that she was committed to kind of the literary integrity of her right. characters. She wasn't going to force the character into something simply because her readers wanted her to. And for Sayers, she had originally started off with this character and she felt like, no, this character is not going to develop into the traditional Christian character.
Mm-hmm. And to talk about another character in her fiction, Harriet Vane, in Gaudy Night, when she's going back to Oxford, there's a certain reflective desire to be acknowledged as a scholar, even though she'd made her math path as a popular writer. So hearkening back to our earlier discussion, that is a development of character that's maybe unexpected, as you were talking about with Lord Peter. But how much do you think that there's no doubt, and you underscore that in many delightful ways throughout your book, that Sayers loved what she did, no matter the variety of genres. But how much do you think there was that underpinning of a little bit of longing and a little bit of angst for the fact that she did not take the academic route?
I think there was some angst about that. I think that she is able to explore those feelings with Harriet Vane. You know, as Harriet goes back to Oxford and looks at kind of the life that she could have had, I think there's a little bit of Sayers there. But I also think that she would have felt confined by that life as well, mm-hmm. because she also does convey that, you know, and she looks at, particularly in Gaudy Night, she looks at the type of women who are content in that role, staying in Oxford, doing their research. And I find it interesting that the personalities of these women are not Sayers' personality. There was a sense that she really wanted to engage with the world. She had what she calls in a great lecture, a sense of vulgarity, of mm-hmm. loving the common, loving cinema, loving detective fiction. Those elements that didn't fit neatly with the academic world of Oxford. And so I think, yeah, I think there was some longing, but I think she recognized that she ultimately chose the correct path yeah. for who she was.
No, I think that's very perceptive. And one interesting thing over the years, as I've talked to young women who've recently graduated from college and they end up reading Gaudy Night, it actually speaks to them because most of them are not taking the academic path, but they were good and mm-hmm. they love the scholarly world. And it, in an odd way, it comforts them because it validates that they have not given up that part of their life, their intellect, their mind. And that's something they're kind of grappling with. Who are they? And I think that's less culturally relevant right now than it was certainly in Sayers' days or maybe even some decades, but it's still an issue, I think, for women at times.
Mm. Yeah. One of the essays that you access and cite in your book is Sayers' The Importance of Being Vulgar, and your reference to the vulgar reminded me of that. Can you explain for our readers what she thought the importance of being vulgar was?
Certainly. That's actually one of my favorite things that I reference in the book. And the importance of being vulgar, she really focuses on vulgar as being kind of the people. Mm. And so she goes through a list of things that are considered to be vulgar. And they are things like love and, you know, just these really kind of elemental qualities of what it means to be human. And so she's redefining, and I see her in that really fighting against this idea of highbrow literature where, you know, oh, no, we don't want to deal with things of the common person, where she goes through, Sayers goes through and says, you know, okay, Shakespeare, let's talk about vulgarity. You know, let's look at the issues that are going on in Shakespeare. Let's look at love. Let's look at hate. Let's look at revenge. Let's look at all of these things that make Shakespeare and his works so classic, things that we go back to. And it's really a critique of highbrow literature for saying, you know, wait a second. These are elemental human emotions. You can't just ignore them. And so she really wants to say, no, there's value in that. You shouldn't be so academic that, you know, you don't dare to talk about real relationships between people.
And that's something you do well in your book, is showing how scholars in England at the time were quite intentionally snooty about literature, that literature should not, true literature doesn't appeal to the masses. What my students were always amazed when I told them that the Latin Vulgate, you know, the Bible that the church was trying to protect, and that so they burned Tyndale at the stake for trying to translate the Bible into English rather than Latin. But the Vulgate Latin Bible is called that because it's written for the people. It was the language of the people. They are the vulgar. The Vulgate is for the people. And we lose that sense and start sanctifying things that are traditional. And what I love about Sayers is she's constantly poking pins into these elitist balloons that were developed at her time while still committed to ancient truths.
Very true. One of the most enjoyable parts about writing the book was doing some research on a married couple who were critics in the early 20th century, F.R. Leavis and Q.D. Leavis, and they were incredibly influential.
Mm-hmm.
And diving into their works, discovering things where you read it and then you have to stop and reread it because you think they can't have actually said this. So there is actually a statement in one of Q.D. Leavis's works where she talks about the worst thing that ever happened to literature was the rising literacy rate. So as more people were able to read, her argument is literature was then dumbed down to the common person.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's exactly what Sayers is trying to counter, to say, no, this was great.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to embrace this and write to everyone and
right.
not just the elite, which the Leavises were really focused on. Let's write to the elite and then maybe they will be able to influence everybody else. But we don't need to actually write to everybody else.
Kind of like intellectual trickle down theory.
Precisely.
Or something. I was interested upon reading your book that the Leavises, and of course I had heard about them because I went to grad school in English, but they were disdainful of Milton, Tennyson, Shelley, Dickens, all the people now that students are being taught in colleges and think, oh, these are the great elevated writers of the past.
Yes, they pretty much anybody that they considered to be too popular, they feel like, no, we should not be paying attention to those writers. And particularly for me as a Victorianist, it's so hard to read their works because they would be happy to just jump over the entire Victorian period. They will go through and talk about, you know, Dickens pandering to his audience, you know, and they pretty much pan everyone. They eventually change their mind about Dickens and say, okay, no, I guess there is a place for Dickens. Pretty much, yeah, they in the Victorian period, they say, you know, because the writers were trying to write to a common reader, that they were not doing good work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Christine, when you talk about these various critics in your book, you There's something you do that I've noticed you do just in your own scholarship. You have a generosity of spirit. And you go on to talk about that. In fact, you quote our former colleague, Alan Jacobs, Hermeneutic of Love. And so I'm wondering if you could elaborate just a little bit, especially for the sake of young scholars. There's, you know, a tendency to think the critique needs to be hostile and denigrate something to be valid. You're taking a very different tack.
I try to treat other people as I would want them to treat me, honestly.
Huh. What an interesting idea.
And, you know, and recognizing that even with people who violently disagree, there might actually be some connection. So one of the interesting things I found with Sayers and the Leavises was that actually they were responding to the same exact thing. They were worried about the education of the masses. And so they were inspired in the same way to say, okay, we need to do something. They just had very different reactions to it. Mm-hmm. And so trying to recognize, okay, these are complex people with complex motivations. And, you know, acknowledging the points when they say things that are just clearly wrong. You know, I think literacy is a good thing. And, you know, so being able to point that out about Q.D. Leavis. But really recognizing, you know, that complexity, I think, is an important aspect. I also think that Sayers is a great model for this. I talk in the book using Alan Jacobs' ideas and kind of showing how Sayers herself becomes what I call a charitable reader. And one of the key things that Sayers was really committed to is she wanted to focus on writers that she felt a kinship with. And she very clearly says, I want to work on writers that I love, because it's too easy to bash writers that I don't love. And so she'll talk about the fact that she talks explicitly that she's not going to write on the poetry of Yeats because she doesn't get it. It doesn't resonate with her. And so she wants somebody else to do that, recognizing that they're able to see things in Yeats that she cannot. And she'll focus on other writers that she does have this kinship with. And in the book, I talk particularly about her writing or her interactions with Tennyson, which I think was a lovely example of this, because pretty much everybody else in the early 20th century hated Tennyson. And so the fact that Sayers actually stood up for Tennyson, I really liked that about her.
Mm-hmm. That was something I learned from your book. I did not realize that Sayers had gone out and actually lectured several times on Idylls of the King, which surprised me. I could see C.S. Lewis doing that because Idylls of the King is about the Arthurian story. I just hadn't noticed Sayers' interest in the Arthurian before. So thank you for that. In light of the importance of being vulgar, one of the things you talk about is Sayers' critique of capitalism. Can you tease that out a little bit? Because many people enjoy identifying Sayers as she was fundamentally politically conservative. But repeatedly, I notice in her writings, she expresses reservations about capitalism.
Yeah, Sayers has really interesting ideas about capitalism. I think for me, it always goes back to kind of her fundamental belief on the purpose of work and the value of work. And so one of the things that really disturbs her is when society develops in a way that people are making things that aren't valuable. Because she feels like, no, they need to have kind of worth in what they're doing. And if they're creating things that aren't worthwhile, it just is, it creates a society in which, you know, people aren't invested in what they're creating. People aren't invested in what they're buying. She hates the idea of, you know, flimsy things that you just buy and throw away. She actually talks about the fact that during the Second World War, one of the good results of that was that people returned to quality goods. And the value of, you know, this is well made because I need to, you know, be able to hold on to it for a long time. And kind of she liked the kind of sloughing away of the things that weren't essential as people began to focus on what was essential. And so a lot of her ideas really focus on how do we make sure everyone is doing good work, valuable, creating valuable things, and avoiding the problems of, oh, we have an excess of this, so we're just going to dump it here. And so that for me is really the core, this idea of everybody being committed to do good work and to purchase good work.
Mm-hmm. Well, and ties into her very shocking statement, but profound, where she says, the only Christian work is good work well done. And she wrote a whole book about that, and she is really on to something. Until you spoke, it didn't occur to me how that kind of ties into Queenie Lewis wanting to keep people, the lowbrow, illiterate, because in a capitalist system, you have to have people who are willing to do all the jobs, the tasks that none of the rest of us want to do. So if they get too literate, they may not want to clean our toilets anymore.
Yeah. You know, what Crystal just brought up about the only Christian work is good work well done. And Sayers, in a similar way, will talk about that's not my proper job. I can't do it well, and so on. And it seems a number of people, at least, often critique her for that and say, oh, she's arrogant. You know, they're not hearing the second side where she's saying, I can't do a good job with that. But you do an interesting comparison of those two aspects, and you say she has an equal commitment to the integrity of her craft and the needs of her audience. Now, why do you think so many people who critique her grasp the first but don't ever notice the second part of that commitment?
That's an interesting question. I think perhaps they don't notice it because they tend to spend more attention on Sayers' own statements, you know, particularly those statements when she says, no, I'm not going to do this because it's not my job, which, just as a side note, considering that even in today's society, women often have a difficult time saying no, I think that's actually a thing that is admirable about Sayers, where she was not afraid to say no to things.
Mm-hmm. In fact, it kind of shocked me when I started reading her, because I had been so socialized to be gracious, and she would just not put up with guff and sexism.
No, she just says no, that's inappropriate.
Well, and it's not all that dissimilar to, I mean, the parable where, you know, the one's son is, you know, is asked to go out and to do the work and says no, and the other one says, oh, I will, but doesn't go.
Mm-hmm.
But the one who said no goes. Mm-hmm. Well, David and Crystal have a wonderful presentation they do. They call the Feisty Friendship, where they're talking about its letters between Lewis and Sayers. And Sayers basically, you know, does her immediate emotive thing, saying, you know, you know, you like souls, I don't, you take him, I don't want to, you know. But she then spends hours writing careful, thoughtful answers to this man's question, who has inquiries about faith. So there's that, I think there's that pushback. And I think part of that was she needed to earn a living.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a lot of people dependent on her. So she couldn't always do all the things that were needed, but she still fit them in.
Right, right. Well, and I think, you know, going back to the original question, that it's easy to focus on those moments when she says no and just think about her as, you know, just focusing on the integrity of the art and in a sense, turning her into more of a highbrow. You know, I am too good for all of these other things. But one of the things that I try to do in the book is really focus on how through her careful research, her careful study, she was really attuned to, I want to craft something that is going to be engaging for my reader. It's going to be fun to read, but it's also going to be really powerful in terms of themes, in terms of characterization. And I think one of the things I find interesting about a lot of people who talk about Sayers is they don't really dive deeply into her works. And that was really my goal. I actually spent 2 full chapters talking about her novel, Nine Tailors, trying to do a really close reading of that novel and comparing it both to Bleak House by Charles Dickens and also a couple of novels by the Victorian writer Wilkie Collins, because I really felt like The Nine Tailors was interesting and complex enough to do that. But I also felt like, okay, this is what's missing. The care, paying attention to the care with which Sayers was crafting her novels and the way that she was doing that, particularly as a gift for her readers, you know, so playing with these conventions, doing interesting things so that she could give them both an exciting read and also, interesting themes and ideas to reflect on after they finish reading.
That would go back to this issue of capitalism in so far as perceiving of your work as a gift means you aren't doing it for capital. You aren't doing it in order to earn money. And as soon as people put money first, they are going to be manipulating the work for the sake of money rather than for the sake of the reader as a gift.
I think the perfect example of that is actually Sayers' novel, The Nine Tailors, because she was so invested in writing it and getting it correct that she actually fell behind in her schedule. And her publisher was waiting for a novel. And so she actually wrote Murder Must Advertise,
right,
really quickly, because she thought she had that background in advertising. I can just, you know, get that novel written quickly to satisfy my publisher. And then I'm going to go back to Nine Tailors and actually spend the time that I need to develop that into the novel it should be. And I just love that about Sayers, that she didn't say, "Ooh, I've got to get this done, so I'm going to shortchange this one novel," but said, "No, I can do another novel more quickly, and then I'll come back to The Nine Tailors."
Mm-hmm. Well, both of you are touching on something that Sayers, I talked about Sayers needing to make a living, and the fact is she didn't make light of the fact of putting the work first because she did need money. It wasn't that she came from a very affluent background. So it was an honest commitment to doing what she believed was the right thing, and it wasn't someone who was could be indulgent because they had great capacity.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Right. Well, and she was also really fighting against the idea that writing is not work.
Yes.
Because she would get a lot of requests that would treat writing as, oh, this is easy for you. Just, you know, whip something out and, you know, and present it. And she was very clear. I mean, in some of her letters, she would actually kind of say, okay, it would take me this many hours, and this is how much I believe those hours are worth. And really clearly trying to say, no, writing is work. It's not, you know, just this hobby that I do that I can just kind of whip things out very quickly.
Yeah, in fact, that was one of the sources of a little bit of tension between Lewis and Sayers, because he wanted her to do an essay that served a certain purpose that she didn't feel that's what she was called to, that it wasn't her work. And I love her statement in a letter to Lewis about the whole issue. She said something like, "I don't fancy going to heaven and appearing before the carpenter's son and saying, 'Well, I made this table. The wood was green and the glue bad, but it was church furniture.'"
Yeah, and that's precisely, I think, what was kind of underlying all of that. I mean, her sense of, no, if I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it well. And it's going to be what I am called to do. Because if I'm not called to do it, I will make the, you know, the bad table. And she's very clear that, you know, making the bad table, even if you're making it for church, it's still a bad table.
Right.
And that is the crime in itself.
Right.
Maybe that's part of what people mistake, that passion that she had. They mistake that for arrogance.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Because truthfully,
Yeah. Well, and I think that is also part of charitable reading. I mean, as I read some of Sayers' letters, particularly those where she's trying to fight back against somebody who wants to do something, I tend to see that frustration, that desire, I want to do the best job possible, and you are not helping me do the best job possible. And so I really read those letters as kind of an output of her own frustration of I'm being hindered in the task I'm supposed to do rather than arrogance. Mm-hmm. You know, I am above anybody telling me anything else.
Mm-hmm. You know, that reminds me, one of the things we have here at the Wade Center is we have this wonderful collection, as you've talked about, of Sayers' own writings, but we also have letters that people wrote to her in response to many of the things she wrote. In particular, Man Born to Be King, her radio dramas on the life of Christ, generated a lot of response, a lot of fan letters, and I think it's interesting that she kept them.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
But there's so much in there. You know, you talk a little bit about the positive response, and one of my favorite letters that's in there is from a teacher who wrote after one of the broadcasts and said to Sayers that the children are bringing in their Bibles and saying, show us where the story is. And that that speaks so powerfully to the success of what she did. And so that's wonderful. And it, but she was also concerned about the fan response, that they missed the theology. Even though she wanted them to hear the story, she felt like they separated it. Could you elaborate on that?
Sure. So with The Man Born to Be King, one of the reasons I love those radio plays is I love the fact that Sayers was writing them directly in response to the fact that the nation was at war. They were produced during World War II. And, you know, if we think back to that particular time period, we're talking about a time period when people didn't have a lot of outlets for entertainment during the war. You know, it's not like today when it's like you can watch a multitude of things, you can listen to a multitude of things. So, you know, these radio plays airing on BBC, this was a big deal. And she really took advantage of that opportunity to say, okay, these are the key things I want people to pay attention to. And her main focus throughout The Man Born to Be King was to help the British public understand the idea of the incarnation, that Jesus was a real human being as well as being God. I love the fact that throughout the play she refers to Jesus as Jesus bar Joseph, you know, this person who was existing in this time period, who was also God, and trying to get her readers her listeners at this point, to understand that. And so for Sayers, this project had really important theological resonance. And she was really, it's interesting to see her responses to the letters, because the people who grasped that get a very enthusiastic response of, yes, you know, that's what I was trying to do. But I don't know that she expected the listeners who would say things like, oh, this story is so much better than the story in the Bible because it's, you know, it's so much more interesting, you know, and she's like, no, not the point. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, this needs to draw you back to the Bible and to the theology. And so she was very careful in responses to people to say, don't let that enthusiasm for, you know, the novelty of listening to it, don't let that be your guiding force. You need to go back to scripture. You need to go back to theology because that's where the truth is. Mm. And so she was really hoping that it would kind of bring people back to the Bible, just like the children coming, you know, and bringing their Bibles and saying, where is this in the Bible? And was really disturbed when that didn't happen. Particularly, I remember a letter where a woman wrote and said, you know, she'd been in the church for a long time. She'd never, you know, really connected, but it was only through the radio plays. And Sayers was like, that's good. Go back to the Bible. Go back to theology. Because she was worried.
That brings us back to the importance of being vulgar insofar as what made the plays so successful is she used vulgar language. She used everyday language. She used slang. It got her in trouble. Just as Tyndale was burned at the stake for translating the Vulgate, she was almost crucified in the press for wanting to use the language of the people, when the irony is we know the disciples were working class people. Of course they used slang. But this sanctification of language itself, what she calls bibliolatry, that people worship the language of Christianity more than worshiping Jesus.
Yes, that is, I mean, it's fascinating to go back and look at everything surrounding, you know, that first, the first airing of her first play. And, you know, you had, I mean, the fact that one of the petitions made it to Parliament, it actually got discussed in Parliament, you know, the fact that she was going to be using, you know, common language and, heaven forbid, American slang.
Right.
And, you know, and it's interesting because, you know, Sayers has all of these comments about, you know, all righty, so King James English, that's exactly what they were speaking back then, you know, because that's what everyone wanted wanted her to be using. But yeah, she was really focused on, no, I need my audience to understand that Jesus was a real person. And in order to understand that, he and the people around him need to speak the language that sounds real, which is not King James English.
Right. In fact, Marge told me this great story that she ran into someone who actually said, well, if King James English was good enough for Jesus, it should be good enough for us.
Precisely, yes.
I know. It's we forget how time-bound we are. And we don't, but that's Sayer's point about understanding truth and understanding theology is that is the only way to keep it in appropriate perspective. And I mean, so many letters, somebody will write her with a question and it may come across at times as dismissive. I don't think it was. It's a matter of fact, she says, no, that's such and such a heresy. And that was defeated at this point. I mean, she knows all that instantly. But that's what keeps her writing in a truthful way, not in her own perspective or thinking the King James language, for example, is the language. If you don't understand the history, you don't understand the theology, you're going to miss the truth.
Right.
That brings us back to the start of our discussion about Middlebrow, so that she was still had a very sophisticated understanding of church doctrine, the history of Christianity, the heresies of Christianity. But at the same time, she used language that the common person, the vulgar, could understand.
Right. And she really felt that theology was applicable to daily life. She talks about, you know, heresies come about as people are trying to figure out, okay, wait, how is God interacting in the world? How do we understand that? And so she was definitely trying to break away from this idea that theology is only discussed by theologians and it's obscure, it's difficult to understand, and has no connection to how we live our lives. And for Sayers, that was completely untrue because how we live our lives shows our actual theology. And we need to know what we believe and link it to how we act. And for Sayers, that's how she brought it to the common person to say, no, you know, this is intensely important for who you are as a person, how you live your life.
That reminds me of something C.S. Lewis wrote to some seminary students at one point. was responding, and he said, if you can't put your faith into the vernacular, you don't know what you believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that is a great word to end on. Thank you so much, Christine, for writing this book. And you have another book coming out on Sayers, so we'll probably be talking to you again sometime next year.
Well, thank you for having me.